Hello, and welcome to Get Yourself Published, Promote Your Research, a webinar series from the Himmelfarb Library Scholarly Communications Committee at the George Washington University, and supported by the Clinical and Translational Science Institute at Children's National Hospital, the GW School of Medicine and Health Sciences, the Milken Institute School of Public Health, and the GW School of Nursing. In this 8-part series, we explore tools, resources, and tips that can help you get your research published and ensure that it is widely read and cited. Our 30-minute pre-recorded bi-weekly webinars cover topics including publishing models, journal selection tools, predatory publishing, copyright citation metrics, publishing identity management, bibliographic management tools, covenants, and more. Our webinars are publicly available and licensed under a Creative Commons license, although some resources discussed in this series are only available to faculty, staff, and students with access to Himmelfarb Library resources. Today, we will be talking about an introduction to scholarly publishing. My name is Paul Levette, and I am a reference librarian at the Himmelfarb Health Sciences Library. The objectives of this webinar are to introduce you to the traditional publishing models, how this is changing to newer publishing models such as open access, and the implications of open access article processing charges and how they might affect you, and provide information about what editors are looking for when they evaluate an article submitted for publication. The Association of College and Research Libraries says scholarly communication is the system through which research and other scholarly writings are created, evaluated for quality, disseminated to the scholarly community, and preserved for future use. The system includes both formal means of communication, such as publication in peer-reviewed journals, and informal channels, such as social media. The diagram on this slide illustrates the traditional scholarly publishing cycle. After research and analysis is complete, a researcher typically wants to convey their findings in a peer-reviewed journal article. Authors submit a manuscript to a journal publisher, who then assigns the paper to a subject matter expert for peer review. Reviewers offer feedback, and the manuscript may be edited before it is published. Readers connect with the article in a variety of finding ways, sometimes years after the article was published, sometimes discussed in the weeks and months following publication, in editorials and letters. Later, it may be cited by other researchers, and later still, if the analysis proves durable, verifiable, and popular, some of the findings may be republished in textbooks and guidelines. Published knowledge may in turn be questioned in light of new information, raising questions and hypotheses for research, thereby initiating further cycles of the traditional publishing model. Emerging research suggests the traditional scholarly publishing cycle is not a linear process, but has a series of feedback loops and connections, with some actions repeated multiple times. A professor of English and writing consultant, Christine Tully, drew this diagram to show how authors take action outside the publishing cycle to promote their research. An author might start promoting research as soon as study findings are analyzed, as a way to gain interest, or after receiving feedback from journal peer review, they might crowdsource suggestions for addressing criticism. Or, an author might post a draft manuscript on a preprint server such as Archive, ChemArchive, and BioArchive as a means of getting peer feedback prior to an official submission to a scholarly journal. And increasingly, researchers are developing author profiles on social media, or, with the NIH-NSF BioSketch, create multiple profiles to highlight particular research to support different grant applications. With traditional publishers of subscription journals, usually the author does not pay a fee to publish, provided they sign over to the publisher copyright of the manuscript. This does vary depending on the publisher. Under the traditional model, the incentive for the author is to aim to publish in a high-impact journal in their discipline. The reader gets access to the full text, provided they in turn have access to a library with a subscription to the journal. Some grant providers require authors deposit a copy of the manuscript in an open access repository, so publishers typically impose an embargo period that typically lasts 12 months, so only subscribers have early access to the article inside the embargo period. Early career researchers might be attracted to publish in open access or newer journals where accepted articles are published immediately. While journal impact factor ranking matters more for renewal of academic tenure, Christine Tully said that in some disciplines, particularly the humanities, the offer of early release of accepted research is particularly attractive for US-based faculty on a tenure track who must publish as much as possible within the first 5 to 7 years of hire. Open access journals generally charge an article processing charge to publish. On average, this is about $3,000 per article, but in return, the article is made free to read immediately. An author subject to a funder mandate to deposit a manuscript in an open access repository may avoid needing to publish in an open access journal, but those repositories follow the traditional journal publisher's 12-month embargo. So a $3,000 open access article processing charge might be thought of as the opportunity cost for getting an article made freely available to read immediately upon publication. If that is thought desirable, authors ought to consider asking grant principal investigators to include a publications line item in future grant budget proposals. Moving on to what a journal editor is thinking when reviewing a submitted manuscript, Dr. Jose Merino, formerly US Clinical Research Editor at the BMJ Neurologist, used this slide to illustrate the process from submission to acceptance. The popularity of publishing in his journal is evident in the figures he quotes. Of 5,000 submitted manuscripts each year, just 4 or 5% are accepted. Budding authors should therefore develop an understanding of the review process at high-impact journals. Upon submission, a new manuscript is given an initial screening by the editorial team. Initial scrutiny is meant to identify potential articles that meet a defined criteria for what the journal considers publishable. Particular attention is paid to the study methods and validity. One of the first questions asked is the degree to which an article reports research that is original, important, and tests a specific hypothesis developed from previous work on the topic. Dr. Heather Van Epps and editors at The Lancet Group consider whether the findings are likely to affect clinical practice, are generalizable, change existing knowledge, are based on good study design, and ultimately reveal new understandings of disease mechanisms. The Lancet Group editors also look for disqualifying criteria, such as lack of statistical power, unaccountable cohort loss to follow-up, unplanned analyses, or articles that report a previously published sub-analysis of existing study data. An author considering submitting a manuscript ought to also think about the reach and accessibility of a journal. There can be many factors behind selecting a journal in which to publish, and in the next webinar in this series, my colleague Sarah Hoover will talk more about journal selection tools. Most journal websites have an advice for authors page that describes, among other things, the scope of the articles accepted for publication. Dr. Merino, formerly editor at the BMJ Neurologist, says that journal prioritizes articles that are on reviews of risk factors, outcomes and treatments, diagnostic tests, cohort studies, health policy, or that report the results of clinical trials comparing the effectiveness of novel interventions against the current standard of care. The Lancet group editors also consider similar types of article, but also apply a hierarchy of evidence to prioritize submitted manuscripts. So, for example, studies that focus on investigative methods or clinical trial protocols are considered outside the scope, so are not published in their journals. Meanwhile, retrospective studies and individual case reports or case series are given lower priority than randomized trials or clinical translational studies. This does not mean there is no value to the articles considered outside the scope of a journal, just that the editors have a different focus for the practitioner discussion and impact around what they choose to publish in their journal. If you have any questions about the material covered in this webinar, or have questions specific to your own research, don't hesitate to contact me at prlevette@gwu.edu. Here are my references. Thank you for taking the time to listen to an introduction to scholarly publishing, a part of the Get Yourself Published, Promote Your Research webinar series from the Himmelfarb Library. If you enjoyed this webinar, please join us for the next installment in our series, Journal Selection Tools, Choosing the Right Journal for Your Research, which will be released on Wednesday, February 26, 2020 at 12 p.m. Please fill out our feedback survey by following the link on this slide.